sulle, kes sa oled tulnud kuulama neljandat saadet virtuaalsest podcastide sarjast Minu tervis. Täna on 28. jaanuar, kell on saanud 6 ja sina oled taas siin ja minul on selle üle äärmiselt hea meel. Oma senistes saadetes Minu tervise egiidi all oleme me rääkinud inimese psühholoogiast, inimese unest ja Hiina meditsiinist. Ja täna kaevume me teaduse imelisse maailma ja mul on äärmiselt suur au, et mul on niivõrd eksklusiivne külaline täna. Minu külaline on Oxfordi toidu, aju ja käitumise instituudi üks neljast teadlaste kogu liikmetest. Ta on endine Suurbritannia valitsuse ravimiohutuse komitee vanem teadusnõustaja ja kuningliku meditsiiniühingu toidu ja tervisefoorumi esimees. Lisaks sellele on ta ka veel mitmete raamatute autor. Ta on kliiniline ekspert, kes juhib prekliinilisi ja kliinilisi ravitoitumise sekkumise teemalisi katseid üle maailma. Minu külaliseks on minu väga suur eeskuju ja mentor, Dr. Paul Clayton. Welcome and thank you for joining me today. It is a true honor.
Oh, not at all. It's a pleasure to be here, wherever here is.
The here is on the Facebook wall, actually. This is 21st century. Mm-hmm. You are a clinical pharmacologist. And you went through the ordinary education of medical pharmacology pipeline like all the other of your course mates in Edinburgh University.
Yes, I did.
But from one point, you were more drawn towards the prevention of diseases rather than towards the post-symptomatic treatment of diseases. And it seems that you have made it a mission for yourself. And there has to be somewhere a totally fruitful and excellent soil for that. Where do the roots of your passion lie?
I think mission is a very grand word, and I'm not sure I would claim anything like that. Basically, I'm a jackdaw. I like shiny pieces of research and I collect them. And subject matter that I find interesting, where I can see, or I think I can see new connections, new possibilities, has always drawn me. So that's been pulling me, I think, on the one hand, but what was pushing me was a realization really quite early on that the pharmaceutical model was really not something that could ever be relevant to public health. Almost by definition, the pharmaceutical pharmacology is all about the treatment of symptoms of disease. And that's baked into the cake, because if you trace the historical origins of the pharmaceutical model back to its beginning, and you know, there's a whole group of really important and very influential and wonderful scientists who contributed to this. And you can say a lot of it starts with the Dutch microscopist von Leeuwenhoek, who first put a couple of spectacle lenses together to make a kind of basic microscope. And he was able to visualize what he called animalcules swimming around in drops of rainwater. And for the first time, people became aware of the fact that there were very small life forms all around us. And the germ theory kind of takes over from the miasma theory. This is all history. And then you have the really amazing work by people like John Snow, the German microbiologist Robert Koch, Paul Ehrlich, who gives us Salvarsan, and then culminating in Louis Pasteur. And we then start thinking about these diseases, and the most important diseases at that time were infectious. We then started thinking diseases as being caused by microbes, and then from that springs the idea of finding a bullet that will kill the microbe and not the man. That's the magic bullet. That's where it starts. And it is absolutely appropriate when you're dealing with diseases caused by pathogens, microorganisms, because there are many points of metabolic differential between a microbe and a man, or I should say a human, but I like the alliteration. So that works. And the antibiotics have worked very well for a long time, although they're working less well now because we've overused them. But this is simply, that became embedded in the medical brain, in the industrial drug model. And so we just went hell for leather down this very, you know, increasing specificity, more and more and more magic bullets, this very military, very masculine metaphor that we could kill diseases without killing too many of our patients. Now, yeah, it does not work for the chronic degenerative diseases, where they're caused not by a single microbe, except in very small number of cases. They're largely caused by multiple metabolic errors, and in some cases, genetic errors. And those in turn are largely caused by a lifestyle that is so far away from our evolutionary and nutritional origins that effectively we're now being chronically poisoned by our lifestyles, and very specifically by the modern diet. And because so many things are going wrong, and because there are so many critical points where if something is really wrong, that could lead to this disease, but you could also get into the same, what looks like the same disease from many other points. First of all, those diseases are not diseases in the microbiological sense at all. They're syndromes, they're common endpoints, which you can arrive at from many different starting points, some genetic, some environmental, some nutritional. So from this perspective, the idea of trying to kill that disease or stop it with a single magic bullet is absurd. It's completely, obviously absurd. And I was, you know, starting to become aware of that half a century ago, when I was just starting medical school and dissecting my first cadaver, and learning Gray's anatomy and doing all that kind of stuff. So a lot of other people were looking at dietary transitions. And the transition phase is something that we talk about when a country starts to move away from a traditional diet and starts to move to the modern diet, which is very much more processed and indeed ultra processed. And everywhere where that has happened, you've seen this huge increase in the frequency of all the chronic degenerative non-communicable diseases and a decrease in latency. So we're seeing more of them. They're occurring in younger and younger groups. Clearly we're being poisoned. And but being poisoned, it's a death by 1,000 cuts, not a single microbe, 1,000 cuts, each of which, or most of which, are derived from this modern ultra-processed diet. So drugs clearly went the way forwards. Clearly, it was time to explore this interesting new world of, and actually it's an old world, of natural pharmacology, the medicinal properties of foods and food derivatives. And this was sort of in its infancy 50 years ago. But so it was easy for me to get into it because I had a pharmacological mindset. I was really already prepared to start thinking about the pharmacological activities of foods and food derivatives at a time when not many other people were doing it. And I just followed it. I followed it to see where it went. And you know what they said, the Chinese saying, if you sit by the river for long enough, the bodies of your enemies will float past. And just because I've been doing it for so long, I seem to have become a part of the landscape and people listen to me, but I don't consider myself to be brilliant or a great scientist or anything like that. No, I really don't. I'm over time, I have become increasingly aware of how much I don't know. And
this is supposedly a mark or a sign of wisdom when you start to understand how much you don't know.
I don't feel particularly wise. I feel very ignorant, more so than I did 50 years ago. 50 years ago, I thought I understood the whole situation. Now I know I don't. And the volume of this, these connections that I know now, I don't know, it's just overwhelming. My perspective is very wide, and I see connections that perhaps specialists don't. But because my field of vision is wide, it's shallow. So I don't consider myself to be an expert in any one field. I know just enough to be dangerous. I know just enough to be able to hold a halting conversation with people in many different disciplines. And then in those conversations, they might give me something, or I'll see something in my researches that I think, ah, wait a minute, that connects to something else I heard from another conference, I saw in another paper. And then I try and put these things together, use these words to make up phrases and then perhaps sentences. And you can think of some of the formulations that I've been involved with as their nutritional or pharmaconutritional sentences. Mm-hmm. I did primary research once. I still do a little bit. I publish maybe 1, 2, or 3 papers every year in sort of different areas, collaborating with many different groups all over the world. And that's a real pleasure for me. But mostly now I'm a kind of a secondary scientist, a bit of a parasite, really. I leech off the work of other experts and I carry those bits home and I try and make something out of it. So, you know, I got here by accident, a series of accidents.
Yeah, there is no such thing as mere chance. But when I Googled, this is a new 21st century verb to Google, there are two terms actually that seem to go hand in hand. One is immunonutrition and one is pharmaconutrition. In PubMed, some authors have suggested already years ago that we should start using pharmaconutrition instead of previously more common immunonutrition. What's the difference between those two?
Well, pharmaconutrition is by definition much broader. If you want to talk about immunonutrition, you are defining an area which describes the use of different nutritional tools to modify various aspects of immune function. Pharmaconutrition, now you're looking at cross-referencing the pharmacological activities of different foods and food derivatives against every physiological process, every type of morbidity. It's a wider discipline. And if I'm anything, I suppose I'm a pharmaconutritionist.
When I Googled again, immunonutritionist, nothing comes up. When I Google pharmaconutritionist, Dr. Paul Clayton is the only one to come up. I know you a bit. I know that you are one of a kind of a human being, but are you really the only person who calls himself a pharmaconutritionist, or what is the closest equivalent to that?
Well, it's not nutritionist, because nutritionists aren't really trained in what I think is a very productive way at all. Mm-hmm. And classical nutrition is something that's not taken particularly seriously by the medical profession, unless you're talking about diets for people with kidney disease or liver disease or things like that. The work that, well, the area that I work and play in contains aspects of physiology, biochemistry, immunology, metabolomics, proteostasis. I mean, it sort of dips into a lot of different specialities. And I think there are now a couple of university departments of pharmaconutrition. Mm-hmm. I believe, I'm not sure, but I think that actually I invented this word on a rainy Sunday afternoon where I had nothing else to do, because I was thinking, what does it mean to try to modify people's metabolism, to make them to reduce their levels of risk of various things using these complex networks of foods and food derivatives and derivatives. And I thought, well, it's a pharmacological use of nutritional tools, and I call it pharmaconutrition. And at that point, I was providing services to the Committee on Safety of Medicines, which now no longer exists. It was a forerunner to the British part element of EFSA. And I went in the next day feeling really pleased with myself. And there was a whole bunch of 20 professors sitting around a table. And I said, I think we should talk about pharmaconutrition. And they talked to me and said, what the hell is that? What are you talking about? And, you know, I tried to define it in a rather sort of halting sort of way, because I hadn't thought the whole thing completely through. And, you know, there was some interest. And they said, well, you know, that might be an area to look at. Like, come back to us and talk to us when it turns into something. It took about 30 years for it to become something coherent. And I started to try to write about this in a systematic way. I think I may have written one of the early textbooks of pharmaconutrition, which is a book called Health Defense. Mm-hmm. And which is still being used in some circles, although I think a lot of it is a bit obsolescent. And there were so many people who'd worked on this vitamin, that trace element, this berry extract or whatever. And I thought, well, how can I join all this together? And I tried to draw the first sketch map of what I thought this new continent might be. And I'll freely admit I knew very little about the internal terrain, but I think I grasped some of the basic outlines, and I thought, I think this is where the shape of the continent is. And since then, it's been a constant process of revision and refinement and revision again. I think I see some slight signs of progress, but you know, what one tries to do as a scientist is not necessarily to grasp any absolute truth, but to move in a crab-like manner, mm-hmm. asymptotically towards it. Perhaps we can get closer to it, or at least we can learn to be a little bit less wrong mm-hmm. than we were. And that's what I try to do. That has become really a part of who I am. And that's something that I inherited from my parents, who were both scientists, from the various grandparents and great-grandparents who were also involved in science or teaching or things like that.
So what does an ordinary day of a pharmaconutritionist look like? An ordinary day, the day when you're not giving out your knowledge like you are right now, when you're not giving lectures, but rather, I mean that what do the days look like when you get in the information? What are your sources? What are your routines for that?
Well, I used to go to quite a lot of conferences, and of course, because of this really inane and counterproductive political response to COVID, these lockdowns have been shown conclusively not to work. A paper by John Ioannidis and his colleagues out of Stanford came out 2 days ago, which said, yep, they don't work. All they do is destroy your economy, put people out of work, make them incredibly stressed, increase deaths of despair, and increase the degree of the already unhealthy degree of control that politicians and their backers already have over us. So I don't like all of that. Anyway, live conferences are a thing temporarily of the past, they may return. So I go to visit online conferences these days. I went to one yesterday where I made a fool of myself asking very naive questions in a conference, which was really about the microbiome and what its applications might be, what might be going on. And yet again, I was struck by the incredible complexity of the relationship between diet, the microbiome and epithelial cells in the gut, epithelial cells and immune cells in the gut, those types of cells, and then the central nervous system. I mean, everything connects, absolutely everything connects. And that's another reason why the pharmaceutical approach has been so unproductive, because what we're trying to do, if you're using pharmaceutical tools, and I'm including the biologicals, you're throwing these very clumsy, very simplistic spanners into the workings of a system that is so complex that no one individual, no one research group, not even the entire academic community understand it. The level of complexity is just staggering. And, you know, each year, I think, well, I've learned something a bit this year and I'm a bit further ahead than I was. And then, you know, over the course of the year, I think, oh my God, I've missed this out. I completely misunderstood this. I misinterpreted. It's a larger context. And it's a process, I think, that has no end in sight. This complexity is on the one hand, it can throw you into despair if you're that kind of a person. On the other hand, it's hugely exciting because the fun never stops. The information never stops coming. And I try and capture some of the spirit of this in my blog, where you know, once a week I'll go out sort of trawling for data. I already have some ideas, you know, that I think this is a connection that would be worth exploring. I'll go and look for material, and then I try and stitch them together into a narrative, and I try to make it human by perhaps adding a little bit of personal experience or politics. And I think I've succeeded in producing a format that has something to offend everybody. Mm-hmm. I hope I have. And I have suggested to my blog publisher that he put a parental guidance warning on the landing page. He's thinking about it.
Yeah, I love you. But what I was thinking is that I also turn to, when I don't get all the answers from the books, I sometimes turn to PubMed, for research and to read there. And it is an overwhelming environment. I mean, it has loads of information, and it's in a very sophisticated and scientific language. I sometimes read and I don't believe that it is English at all.
But PubMed is my home, and Google Scholar, and you know, there's a couple of other sites like this. It's where I feel most at home. And it's like a happy hunting ground. So many questions, so much information, so many different trails through this infinite forest of information and ideas and hypotheses. I find it hugely exciting. I think it's perhaps the most interesting and potentially important human project ever.
Mm. But there must be a huge control in PubMed of what to publish and what not to publish. I'm sure that if I did research on three Estonians and trying to publish it on PubMed, it wouldn't be like that. You have been through this machinery for many times. What are the prerequisites to those papers that are published?
Well, if you're asking about quality controls, it's not really about quality controls. PubMed relies on the editorial boards of those journals which are peer-reviewed to do the quality controls. And then PubMed will simply list those papers which have been published in the journals in their database. And so when you wander through this maze, and it's like an adventure game or a role-playing game in a cyberspace, a computer game, you can go on forever. And what you will find as you wander through this theoretical terrain, is that there are certain figures that you get to recognize, and you realize this is usually someone who usually has something substantial and carefully considered to say. And this comes from a research group which has a good track record, or an institution where I know that they have reasonable standards of research and have an issue about credibility and who wish to maintain it. There are other journals where clearly the bar is set rather lower, and there are other research groups, institutions, or individuals that you learn in one way or another don't carry quite as much weight. Then you also look at things like if someone is doing a clinical trial, has it involved a very large number of subjects? Is it a very small number of subjects? Have the power calculations been done properly? Does this hypothesis seem reasonable? Does Occam's razor apply? I mean, it is a bewildering terrain.
Mm-hmm.
And there is material out there which has probably very little intrinsic worth at all, and which can be very misleading. So just because it's in PubMed does not mean to say it's true or accurate or indeed honest.
I was just about to say that if this is such a controlled environment and people who publish their papers and researches there, they actually know what they are doing, and still there are so many papers that come up with such contradictive results.
Like, yes,
you're saying the opposite.
Well, there is a problem. Problems creep in from different areas. And one of the problems that I find really serious is the problems that have been created by the pharmaceutical industry. The pharmaceutical companies have enormous amounts of money. They have been involved, I think, in subverting editorial practice. And quite recently, there was a discussion under the Chatham House rule, which was subsequently leaked by some very senior scientific editors, and they were discussing how the pharmaceutical companies have enough money to be able to cook the data and present it in a way that looks convincing enough to eventually be published, but is clearly dishonest and misleading.
What's the purpose for that? I mean, nobody benefits from that.
To sell their drugs. They will run trials which have been designed to show up their drug in the most positive light. They will find ways of publishing data to which will exaggerate the therapeutic efficacy of their product and downplay the negative aspects of it. So this is a very large and systematic problem that has infected the medical databases.
And then when we read the papers about preventative medicine, about certain nutrients or something, they're all very like general. They are not promising or claiming almost anything, as if leaving all the ends loose.
Well, you know, there is a problem here, and let's just pick a disease area, just let's say at random, osteoporosis. I mean, it could be anyone, but osteoporosis is a serious public health issue. We know the numbers of people affected by it are increasing for a whole set of reasons. And then you go to the medical databases and you see, well, what are the nutrients that might have some application at a public health level to reduce the burden of this condition in the public health context? And you know, there's various papers that give you a hint. Well, it could be something like this. It could be something like that. It could be soy isoflavones, for example. It could be vitamin K2. But so many of these papers are inconsistent and they're not always very repeatable. And the problem is, this is unlike the situation where if you're using a synthetic compound, it's very easy to create a placebo group who are not receiving the drug, and then you have the active group who are. And because these are synthetic molecules that people haven't come across before, you can make the assumption, and it's probably quite reasonable, that if you standardize things like age, sex, BMI, smoking habits, and things like that on both sides, you will end up where, out of all this morass of variables, you will be able to tease out that effect or group of effects that are caused by your synthetic intervention. That's not the case when you're looking at nutrition. So lately I've been looking at the therapeutic effects of exercise regimes on osteoporosis. And some people, there is evidence. We know that when you take physical exercise, the osteocytes, osteoblasts act as mechanotransducers. They pick up on the loading that exercise creates. And that triggers a synthetic pathway that starts with these osteoblasts, which are a subset of fibroblasts. They start producing more osteoid, and then the osteoid is mineralized, and then you have bone. But the thing is, bone is dynamic, and it is operating in a very complex context. So if I were to take a group and say, okay, you have problems with taking exercise. Let's say you have arthritis or you have peripheral neuropathy. I'm going to put you on a vibrating plate. And these have been quite fashionable lately. Look through the literature. And the effects of putting people on a vibrating plate are really inconsistent. Mm-hmm. And the reason is, I believe, that even although putting someone on a vibrating plate will cause mechanical stresses, which will be interpreted by the osteoblasts and the chondroblasts in cartilage as being loading signals, and we should start producing more bone or osteoid or cartilage, that will only work if that person's diet contains all the other cofactors that these cells need to do their thing. And there are many. And it will also depend on whether that person is perhaps doing other things which create chronic inflammatory stress, which are breaking down the ground matrix in cartilage or the osteoid in bone as rapidly as they can build it. So what you then have to do, or at least theoretically, because no one has done this, is to take a population of, let's say, postmenopausal women where you have proven osteoporosis or osteopenia, whatever, wherever you want to start in this is, have a similar type of grade. And then you give them all a comprehensive nutritional program, which will stop chronic inflammatory stress, stop dysbiosis, provide all the micro and phytonutrients necessary to allow the anabolic work to go on. Now you've got a common baseline. Now you can have a group, one which is shaken up on a vibrating plate and one which doesn't. Mm-hmm. And now you can start perhaps through all the noise to filter out what the real impact of that vibrating plate is. You see, there are so many variables here and everything connects. And unless you try and find a way of creating a uniform baseline between your intervention and placebo groups, this person will stumble onto this finding by accident, and that one will find something else, and nothing really fits, nothing coheres, no coherent image emerges. That's one reason why I find, and I'm going to talk about Zinzino now for a moment, but I'm not going to be promotional about it. But Zinzino is interesting to me because with the health protocol, you're rectifying chronic inflammation, you're rectifying dysbiosis, you're rectifying type B malnutrition. That now establishes a baseline. And I could take 100 postmenopausal women who are on the health protocol and divide them into 50 and give one of those, put one subset on the vibrating plate. And because they, all of these people have everything that they need to make bone, I think now within that kind of a group, I might be able to demonstrate more easily the therapeutic effects of an intervention like a vibrating plate or isometric exercise or whatever other form of exercise you want to do. But I think that because we are still so influenced by this monotherapeutic pharmaceutical model, no one has done a trial like this. And because you then have so much noise in the system, so much variability between different populations, different socioeconomic groups, different continents, different nations, different regions within a nation, they're eating different diets, they're doing all kinds of different things. You end up with tens of thousands of little studies, which will give you sort of tantalizing clues, suggestions perhaps, and no more than that. So that's why I always go back to mechanism of action, to pharmacology. You know, the stuff that looks very good in vitro and ex vivo models or in metabolomic terms, you think, well, this makes sense. And then if I'm going to go and get involved in a clinical trial, I'm going to try to make sure that all the other parameters that I know are involved, or as many as possible, are evened out in the active and placebo groups. And only then would I feel confident of having a good chance of documenting the effect of an additional limited intervention.
So all the research done on people who live today on the circumstances that exist today, they are still so different and so difficult to actually come to the same conclusion. So when we,
yes,
and when we then talk about research and topics that are research on topics and hypotheses that take us back in history, that makes me rise my eyebrows even more. And you yourself have dug into mid-Victorian time. It's hard enough to find any conclusions in the blue zones that exist on this globe today, like Okinawa. But you have time traveled to mid-Victorian time and done a research there. How do you do that?
Well, first of all, I was very, very fortunate. I met someone literally while I was in a queue buying train tickets at a station in London, St. Pancras Station. And
just about
that station
was King's Cross and to Harry Potter's land.
Yes, and that station, St. Pancras Station, at the front of it, there's a hotel, which is the most phenomenal example of mid to late Victorian architecture. It's such an exciting piece of three-dimensional sculpture. It wasn't very successful as a hotel because the internal design was completely impractical, which we can go into, but the external design is absolutely beautiful. And I turned to the person next to me in the queue and said, isn't that a wonderful piece of architecture? And it speaks to the amazing self-confidence of the culture at that time. And she said, well, I should think so. That was my great uncle who designed it. And then we started a conversation, and it sort of became apparent even in the first 20 minutes, it was a long queue, that my ideas about public health in the 19th century were wrong. And her ideas about nutrition and modern medicine were wrong. And we felt, well, there's so much here that doesn't match. Maybe we should look at this. I think, you know, for a scientist, those moments of cognitive dissonance, when you realize the models that you have aren't working, should be cherished, because those are the moments when you think, here's something new. We've got it wrong. We need to reinvestigate. And from that unlikely beginning, there sprang a series of papers which, for the first time, described this huge blue zone, an island not geographically defined, but in time. And we couldn't study the mid-Victorians themselves and ask them what they ate. But what we were able to do is to comb through the historical records. And they were very profuse. This was a society that documented itself in considerable detail. And also photographically, this was the dawning of the age of photography. So we know what people look like. We had their birth and death records. We know how long they lived. We know what they died of. We know what they ate because there was comprehensive documentation coming in from agricultural production through transport of foods through the railway systems to what was sold in the stores, in the canteens, in the restaurants, in the street stalls. And we had access to recipe books at the time, menus from hotels, hospitals, lodging houses, and a lot of literary descriptions as well. So we were pulling in information from a multiplicity of different sources. And in the end, I think we were able to develop a very coherent body of information, which showed pretty comprehensively that these people lived as long as we did and were far healthier. And when we first published this, the medical profession were very, very negative. And they said, this is not possible because we've had a century of modern medicine. Clearly things have gotten better. Well, yeah, modern medicine has not made things better for the reasons I discussed at the beginning of this interview. And our nutritional status has degraded. So public health has degraded and got a lot worse. And they said, well, your medicine can't be wrong. Therefore, the rest of your history must be wrong as well. But then the historians came riding up over the hill, like, you know, the cavalry, and said, no, the history is absolutely right, and we have to re-examine everything. And at that point, the medical profession backed off. And said, oh, okay, maybe this was a blue zone. And maybe 100 years of medical research, pharmaceutical research, hasn't really gotten us very far. And the answer is, it hasn't. It really hasn't. It's been a huge blind alley, in a way. So that has gone on to become a very frequently cited paper. So it's referred to a lot. It's considered by some people to have influenced the way in which we think about public health. Mm-hmm. And it is, I think, a really interesting, I think it's a good insight into pre-transitional nutrition and health. So it acts as a kind of baseline against which we can measure and compare the sad state of affairs that exists today.
So some other of your main research areas among besides mid-Victorian time have been essential fatty acids, then beta-glucans, diet fibers, saffron, I guess. How do these different areas or nutrients or hypotheses or questions draw your attention? How does the path lighten up so that you know which way to go? What do you follow?
Well, I mean, very often it starts with, I'll stumble across a paper which seems interesting to me, and I start digging, and then you realize, wait a minute, this connects to that, and this means something else. And then I'll follow it up, perhaps, or it might be a chance meeting with someone who's researching in that area, who has specialist knowledge.
Or but who, standing in the queue.
Or in that case, was standing in a queue, and not even in a medical conference, in a railway station. these things can start from anywhere. When you read a paper, it might make a reference to another paper, and you think, oh, that's maybe something there, and you read that paper and it sends you something else. And then before you know, you've moved so far away from your starting point that you've almost forgotten where you started, but you had discovered a new room in this house of an uncountable number of rooms, an infinite number of rooms. And some rooms just seem to be more interesting or perhaps more important than others. And then when I find something like that, I think, okay, I'll stay here and play for a while and see what there is. And then I'll either write a scientific paper, which I've done in, you know, many occasions, or I'll write a blog post, or perhaps a book.
Or perhaps a book, which I'm very grateful for. You have, for years, you have emphasized, and this is a thing called a silent fire. We are in, we are on fire as human beings. We are in shortage of nutrients, in shortage of exercise, in shortage of majority of the things that nourish our body. And now we are also seeing how much it affects our brain and our mental health. And this, all these different researches that you have done, be it fatty acids or saffron or mid-Victorian time, they have always all led you to this inflammation and being on fire. How have we come so far?
Well, look, first of all, I'm not the first person to think of chronic inflammation as being important, a driver of chronic degenerative disease. I mean, lots of other people were working in this area, and many of them before I even became aware of it. So I don't make any claim to that whatsoever. I think if I've contributed anything to the discussion, is the realization over time that the relationship between diet and diseases of civilization can be refined into a relatively simple model that then affords us possibilities of intervention. There is this idea that the modern diet is somehow wrong. We've drifted off course, and everybody, there is a consensus also, all of my colleagues would agree that we, as a result of this, are seeing more problems of civilization, diseases of civilization, as they are laughably called. But that's a very vague, and it's a poetic way of thinking about these things. How does civilization make us sick? If that's all you can say, then the only way to make us healthier again is to stop civilization. It's just unhelpful. So I was concerned with trying to tease out what was it about being civilized and eating the diet and living the lifestyle that goes along with that? What is it about that in specific terms that causes us ill health? And is there something there that we can modify to remove those deleterious vectors and improve public and individual health? And I think I was the first person to start thinking about this systematically. And that was just because I'd been working so broadly. I'd been working as this sort of parasitic secondary type of scientist, just reading anything that seemed interesting. And I was able to, my lifestyle made it possible for me to be what used to be known as a gentleman scientist. I could just browse here and there. And for most working scientists, you have to be a specialist. That's where the grants come in. And so I began to think, well, okay, chronic inflammation, that's something that is caused by the modern diet and lifestyle, particularly the ultra-processed diet. But it's doing more than that. Chronic inflammation we can address, but that doesn't solve all your problems. The modern diet, the standard American diet, the SAD diet and its variants, also clearly cause dysbiosis. So that's another disease vector. Once your microbiome has become incorrectly configured, you're in for a world of pain and problems. It really makes a lot of other things malfunction. And then the third element was type B malnutrition, because we're physically really not very active. Your typical urbanite or metropolitan person is burning maybe 2,000 calories a day, which is, you know, 30-40% above BMR. It's historically anomalous. It's a very low level of physical activity. So we're eating very little compared to the amounts of food people were eating 100 years ago. The foods we are eating are very depleted in nutrients. We're eating far more, for example, soybean oil, far more sugar. Those are completely empty calories. And this creates a pattern of disnutrition or malnutrition called type B malnutrition. And when you take chronic inflammatory stress, which increases catabolic processes, type B malnutrition, which impairs anabolic processes, throw dysbiosis into the mix, and then add hyperglycemia, hyperinsulinemia, insulin resistance, which comes from our diet and our physically low levels of activity. Now you've got four separate mechanisms, which between them explain really very convincingly the enormous burden of chronic degenerative diseases that now characterize our appalling public health. And I've had the opportunity, as you know, to develop pharmaconutritional tools which are designed to rectify chronic inflammation, dysbiosis, and type B malnutrition. Three out of the four. Mm-hmm. Now, the fourth one is really down to you. It's down to the individual. You can choose, if you want to live a healthier lifestyle, to reduce the glycemic load of your diet, mm-hmm. which means cutting down on sugars and digestible carbohydrates, not fermentable, those are the good ones, and taking more physical activity. And I can't put that in a capsule. That is something you have to build into your own lifestyle. I think that it's difficult for many people to do that because we are living in what the American Heart Association called an obesogenic environment. I would call it a pathogenic environment because we are time poor. Increasingly, we are economically compromised as well, thanks to the growing global depression that seems to be taking place right now. So we go to the store. We don't have time to cook. We don't have the willingness. In many cases, we haven't had the training to do that, to cook with basic produce. And we're surrounded when we get into the multiple retailer by a glittering array of ultra-processed foods, which are cheap, have an infinitely long shelf life, have high profit margins per square foot of shelf, per square foot of shelf space, which look good, and which are designed, frankly, to be addictive. And so we eat too many of these things, even sometimes when we know it's not actually a good thing to do. We eat far too many of them. And the more of these ultra-processed foods you eat, the more likely you are to die, the more likely you are to be overweight, to have type 2 diabetes, to develop cancer, to develop neurodegenerative diseases. You know, the link between this type of diet and our currently worsening state of public health is absolutely clear, blindingly clear. And all that I tried to do is to bring a little bit of order into this chaos and say, well, it's type B malnutrition, chronic inflammation, dysbiosis, and then hyperglycemia, hyperinsulinemia, and insulin resistance. And that goes together with things like sarcopenia and metabesity. That's this whole constellation of things which all kind of come together to be the fourth cause of these tidal waves of chronic degenerative diseases that are overwhelming healthcare systems all over the world.
When we are talking of a shortage of nutrients in our food, then is it also because of the fact that we have kind of like drained our earth and that the vegetables and the fruits are not so potent anymore, that they also are more empty than they used to be?
Again, it's a very poetic idea. I'm not sure there's any really good evidence to support that. If you're living in an area where, for geological reasons, the soil is depleted in a particular trace element, that might well be an issue. But I suspect that what is more important is the combination of deep plowing and the use of NPK fertilizers, which has damaged the mycorrhizal population that grow around the roots of many of our crops, which leads to, it compromises their ability to abstract trace elements from the soil. So that's a little, you know, something that's going on there. But the other thing that is, I think, more substantial is what is known as the breeder's dilemma. And crop breeders have financial incentives to produce strains of crops which are bigger, which are sweeter, which look better. And very often when you do that, you're telling the plant, put all your energy into this, and it has less energy available to develop some of the other compounds, typically tertiary plant compounds, phytoallergens, which we have learned over the millions of years to co-opt when we eat those fruits and vegetables and use as phytonutrients, so the carotenoids, the polyphenols, the methanogens, cyanogens, and a whole range of other phytonutrients that clearly are important and which appear to be present in lower levels in intensively grown modern species. Let me give you an example. many fruits today are so sweet, that so full of sugar, that diabetics can't eat them. That wasn't always the case. If you look at heritage species, you see that they tend to be smaller, they tend to be far less sweet, they tend to be had to contain much more interesting flavor profiles with bitter notes, with aromatic notes, which actually signaled the presence of some of these really important phytonutrient compounds. Take the grape today. You can buy grapes here in the United States called, I think it's called candy floss grapes, but there's other variants like that. And they are sickeningly sweet because the American palate has been degraded by the food manufacturers. People have become so used to things that are sweet that sugar is being put into foods where it really shouldn't be, including breads. I can't eat American bread.
And meat.
It's more like brioche. And so these grapes are absolutely terrible for you. They're just sweets, confectionery, which are being sold as fruit. And so you think it's healthy, but it's not. But if you go back to look at the original, very, very early grapes, which were grown in the Golden Crescent between the Isis and the Euphrates in the Middle East, they still have them. And they're very much smaller, very fibrous, and really not sweet at all. I mean, there is a sweetness, but very, very little. And because they're much smaller, they have much more surface area per unit of volume. Mm-hmm. So they have to protect themselves more against ultraviolet radiation, pests and predation. They have a far higher ratio of phytonutrients to sugars, mm-hmm. in fact, a healthy one, than grapes do today. So what was once healthy, what was once really, really important to maintaining the integrity, let's say, of the retina and parts of the brain, and in helping to damp inflammation, those fruits which once did those things for us have become toxic. And they've become toxic because we've infantilized the public palate. And because we have been taught to eat with our eyes, we've taught to expect produce which is large and glossy and flawed and sugar sweet. But it's been a huge distortion. It's been a huge perversion of what those foods originally were. And we are suffering as a result.
And here I have to ask you, Paul, are we doomed, or is there a way out into the sunshine of well-being again?
Are we doomed? Well, as individuals, of course. can we reverse these negative trends and help to create a healthier public? I think so. I'd like to do that because I find the current situation rather personally very offensive. I see so many people becoming sick and dying long before that time. So much waste of human potential. So much wasted opportunity. I mean, you referred to me a little bit earlier on as having a little bit of wisdom. I'm not sure I'd agree with that, but if I've become marginally a little bit smarter over the years, it's because I've had time to learn from lots and lots of stupid mistakes. Perhaps some people are just born being wise. I certainly wasn't. And I think most of us need time. We do need time and experience to develop a little bit of an understanding of who and what we are and what our responsibilities are. And what I see when I look around at public health right now is that, first of all, lots of people are dying very, very prematurely, and life expectancy is falling. I think, I don't like this. I do want to change this. I want to give people an opportunity to live longer, hopefully to learn a little bit more about life, about the world, about love. And I think it can be done if we can persuade the major stakeholders in this area to behave differently. And here I think what I'm talking about is the food industry, the pharmaceutical industry, and the medical profession. So the food industry, I think, is grotesquely unethical. They are responsible for an indiscriminate form of genocide. They're killing all of us with their shoddy, highly toxic products. And that's because we're not aware, many at a public level, of how dangerous those foods actually are. It's a little bit like the situation in the 50s or 40s when people could smoke, blissfully unaware of the fact that cigarettes caused cancer. So there isn't a public awareness here that is necessary. And I think that if we can improve public awareness and get to the point where consumer demand starts to shift and people start asking more from their convenience foods, look, we want these to taste good, but we also want them to be less dangerous, perhaps even pro-health. Or if the governments were to develop a sense of moral responsibility, now that's unlikely, I know, but if they then were to say it would be better for these food companies to sell less toxic products because then we would have a healthier population and we wouldn't have to spend so much on healthcare, you know, that might be persuasive to at least some political parties. If we could bring these food companies to heel, we wouldn't be creating so much degenerative disease. But you see, that would hurt the pharmaceutical industry, who make their living off the food industry. They rely on the food industry to supply them with a never-ending stream of people who are chronically ill. And that's how the pharmaceutical industry have risen to the point where they're now in the top three global economic sectors worldwide. At the moment, most people are sort of imprisoned between these two walls, being crushed between these two millstones. And it's going to take a set of miracles to release them. We have to change the food industry. We have to change the pharmaceutical industry. And I think in both cases, what that means is you're asking these people to affect significant changes and even start to dismantle parts of these industries that they own, that they are embedded in, they've made their lifestyles and careers in, that they earn from. So it's not going to be easy. But we're clearly going through an extraordinarily major social, political, and economic transition right now. I don't know if you believe in the fourth turning. I'm not completely convinced by it, but I think it has, again, some kind of poetic resonance. And if you speak to historians about that book, they say, well, no, this is completely wrong. It's completely imprecise. This doesn't work and that doesn't work. But it certainly does feel as if after as a 1950 child, most of my life was spent in Europe in the post-war period. And we saw, many parts of the world saw, half a century, perhaps slightly more, of sustained material, if not spiritual progress, but material progress, certainly. And the institutions that I've just been describing sort of grew fat on the back of that period of increasing prosperity. I think we're reaching the end of that period. Not surprisingly, because those institutions have fundamentally 19th century roots and they're completely obsolete, as are most political parties. And what I sense in many of the countries where I travel is this growing current of anger and frustration and polarization, and this feeling that things can't go on as they are. I think historically, this has always been a harbinger for turbulence and violence. And I don't anticipate that this transition is going to be an easy one. But perhaps on the other side of it, something better might emerge. Perhaps on the other side of it, something that is actually not global. I think globalism is cancerous, but something that is locally based might be a better solution and provide a better future for more of us, as opposed to the digital serfdom, the digital feudalism that is proposed by the current crop of globalists.
So if, as a last question today, if there is someone listening to us and thinking...
Is that likely? I mean, who's going to listen to such a rambling conversation?
That is, by the way, very likely. There is someone who is really thinking that, well, it seems to me that there is something that I can do personally about my own health. I know I've been on that path and still am. So there must be someone else also. If they are thinking that, what is this? What do you say? What is the single most important recommendation from you, what we should do on daily basis in order for our mental and physical health to to really thrive, at least as much as it is possible in like living together with these grocery stores, with this kind of food production? What do we have to do?
Well, I think there's different things that you can do. I suppose you could say that I'm selling my own book, but I believe that by using the health protocol, you will supply your body with the basic ingredients that it needs to function. I don't know if it would be optimally, but certainly better than it does for most people at the moment. But that only puts, you know, the framework in place. Mm-hmm. And, you know, in order to to think more clearly, more effectively, more strategically, you have to learn how to do those things. And start off by probably, I think, turning away from the mainstream media, most of which are little more than propaganda outlets now. The television stations, most newspapers, they are, I don't think very many of them have any credibility left whatsoever. So I don't go there. Look instead for multiple sources of information. Cross-reference as much as you can, as much as you have the time to do. Speak to people who you believe may be credible or have reason to trust, and then question them too. Just be skeptical. And, you know, think, I'll steal something from the environmentalists. Think globally and then act locally. Starting with yourself, and then talk to your friends and your family and find out what works. I mean, all I can do is to give you some very simple nutritional guidelines. It's not much, but perhaps it's a beginning.
I think it's a very good path, not only a beginning, but what do you think is, can we at all in nowadays environment get away without any food supplements? Can we get all what we need from the food that is, as it is stated by so many doctors?
No, it's almost impossible now. If you are running at, say, 3,000 to 3,500 calories a day, because you have very high levels of physical activity, if you have a dietary coach, if you have nutritional support, or just really understand how to make very good food choices and steer away from empty calories, ultra-processed foods and sugars and plant oils, then you probably can. You can probably get away with it. But that's only describing a pretty small minority of people. So for, you know, for people in general, to have an impact on public health, I believe that we have now created a situation where supplements are essential.
So we are in a situation where all the nutrients come from a capsule and we eat out of habit.
Well, you know, I think we talked about this before. If someone were to ask me, how can I live a better life? Well, first of all, I have nothing to say about living a better life, but I can perhaps help you to live a healthier life. And I would say, go and buy a small farm, leave your job in the city, grow the food that the soil will and the climate will permit. Work with your hands, with your back, get the dirt under your nails, get the sun on your back, go down to the coast and catch oily fish and eat some of those too. And that's going to do a lot for most people. Mm-hmm. But it's really an impossible recommendation for most. It's completely impractical. And if you're living on the 8th floor or the 16th floor of a high-rise building in a city, in whichever continent, you're not going to be able to do that. So if you're living a 21st century lifestyle, in order to get the benefits of a 19th century diet, you really have to go to supplements. And as a pharmacologist, I'm not concerned whether you're getting those particular nutrients in a food or in a capsule. It doesn't make any difference. The chemistry is the same, the pharmacology is the same, providing, of course, the formulation has been made properly and the nutrients are in a form that can be absorbed. So that's another really important area, and it's one that I worry about and think about a lot.
Thank you, Paul, for today. It has been, again, as usually, as always, very eye-opening and very informative and very interesting, extremely interesting for me too. So thank you so much for joining us today. And I really do hope that we can do it maybe some other time also.
Oh, no, I've got nothing more to tell you. You know it all now.
Okay. Thank you. Ja aitäh sulle, mu kallis vaataja, selle tunni aja eest ja ma loodan, et sul oli sama huvitav kui mul. Mul on alati tarkade inimestega väga huvitav rääkida. Ma loodan, et sinul oli huvitav ka kuulata. Nii et suur aitäh sulle ja kohtume juba järgmisel neljapäeval. Thank you.